Welcome viewers to this film which is entitled PERT and CPM. This will be presented to you in two parts. In the first part, we are largely going to talk about PERT. Friends, PERT stands for Program Evaluation and Review Technique, while CPM stands for Critical Path Method. We are well aware that there are many large projects which are being developed. In such projects, huge amount of monitoring, scheduling and controlling is required. Both PERT and CPM are the techniques of these project planning and controlling. When we take a look at the introduction, we find that most real life projects are very large and complex. Many a times, tens of thousands of steps and huge amount of money may be involved. They require a large number of activities to be completed in order to complete a project. Project management also involves managing large scale complicated projects. And this is also a difficult problem because the stakes in project management are very high. While the first step in planning and scheduling a project is to develop the work breakdown structure. Now, what do we mean by work breakdown structure? Is that first the project is divided into various phases, then in each phase the activities which are going to be part of those phases are explained. So, that way a large project is divided into phases and then phases divided into activities. For each activity, we require the information related to the time, cost and the resources required. We also require the information about the predecessing activities and as well as the people who are required, and for each activity such resources are identified. Once we have done that, then a schedule for the project can be developed. Project management requires the appropriate management of a large scale project. For example, if a highway is being constructed from city A to city B, this would be a mega project, and this project will be completed in various phases, and there will be large number of activities as a part of this project, and the amount which is required for completing this project will also be a huge financial resources. When we are managing a project, we require answer to certain questions. These questions are when it should be done, meaning thereby that when the project should be taken up. In other words, we are talking about the scheduling of the project. The second question relates to how much and if at all it has slipped from the original schedule. So, that is regarding the project monitoring. So, we will know that the original schedule, whether the project is going as per that original schedule or it has deviated from the original schedule. And once we find out that it has been deviated from the original schedule, we make efforts to put it back on the track. Third question is related to a very important aspect as to what the bottlenecks are. You will agree with me that in every project there can be many bottlenecks, and the proper management of these bottlenecks is required if we have to complete a project well within time. Then the last aspect is that what you might drop to save time, because you will agree with me that in every project there are basically two targets or two goals to be achieved. First one would be the time goal and second one would be the cost goal. Proceeding further, then we see how PERT and CPM are helpful in project planning, controlling and scheduling. As in the beginning of this film, I have told you that both PERT and CPM are very useful here. Some of the project planning related activities are required to be done before project, while some of the project controlling related activities are required when the project is underway during the project. So, those activities related to project planning involve, number one, setting goals, number two, defining the project. As I said that defining the entire nature and scope of the project, also defining that how much will be the nature of the activities which will be performed under this project, they are all covered here. Then tying needs into timed project activities, and finally organizing the team. So these are the four activities which we require to be done at the project planning stage, even before the project has actually started. Now, when we have to take decisions about project scheduling, meaning thereby that when we should begin the project, when each phase should be completed, and when finally the project should be finally completed, so then project scheduling will be required there. Here again, three steps are needed. One, tying resources to specific activities so that we can allocate the resources available for specific activities. Second is relating activities to each other, because we know very well that in every project there are the preceding relationships. Some of the activities cannot be started until unless some of the preceding activities have been completed. Similarly, the third aspects relate to updating and revising on regular basis. Nothing is permanent. When the project has started, then due to certain contingencies, we may require to revise some of the input information. Finally, we come to the third aspect here, that is project controlling. This project controlling will be done as a part of monitoring when the project has been started and the work on the project is going on. Here, monitoring resources, costs, quality and budgets is first and foremost activity involved here. The second one would be revising and changing plans, as I said, as per the contingencies. And third is that sometimes shifting resources to meet demands. When we are allocating more resources on one particular activity, it is going on well in time or sometimes ahead of schedule, but we might have neglected some other activities, and so in order to bring them back on the track, we may have to reallocate some resources from say activity A to activity B, which is lagging behind. So this is how you have got an idea, overview about what is required in project planning, controlling and scheduling. Proceeding further, now we know that these are the two important project management models for project planning and controlling. One is PERT, as I said, this is Program Evaluation and Review Technique, and second is CPM, that is Critical Path Method. Now, both PERT and CPM are two popular quantitative analysis techniques to help us plan, schedule, monitor and control projects. They were developed because there was a critical need for a better way to manage. We know that a project is very large and very complex also in its management, and so these two techniques come as a boon to manage the projects in a very effective manner. Originally, these approaches differed in how they estimated activity times. While PERT is probabilistic in nature, CPM is deterministic in nature. What do we mean by probabilistic? That in PERT, we are not able to assign deterministic time estimates. So in PERT, we use three time estimates to develop a probabilistic estimate of completion time. Therefore, PERT is useful for new projects where we do not have the past data regarding the activity completion time. On the other hand, CPM is a more deterministic model or technique. Here, CPM has been used for repetitive kind of projects where the activities are known to have deterministic time for completion. They have become so similar and so intertwined because PERT also uses the terminology which is the similar to the one which is used in CPM. So the two techniques have become so similar to each other that they are now commonly considered as one technique, that is of PERT/CPM. But still, as I said, there are certain dissimilarities also here. Now, these are the six steps which are used in PERT and CPM. The first stage refers to defining the project and all of its significant activities or tasks, meaning thereby that a project is defined, divided into phases, and phases divided into activities or tasks. Then second step, we talk about developing the relationship among the activities, and we also decide which activities must precede others. Here the technology has a say. If the technology says that activity A and B should be completed, then only activity C can be started. So that will be the precedence relationships governed by the technological considerations. Third step requires drawing the network connecting all of the activities, while fourth step is to assign time and cost estimates in case of CPM to each activity. In case of PERT, we will only be talking about the time estimates. Fifth step is to compute the longest time path through the network. This is called the critical path. So friends, it is very clear to you that first the activities are identified, then their time estimates are given, their precedence relationships are identified, network is drawn, and then from among the network, that path which is having the longest time is chosen as the critical path. Sixth and final step here is that we use the network drawn in such a manner to help plan, schedule, monitor and control the project. That is basically the essence of both PERT and CPM. Now, another thing that you should understand is that the critical path is very important, since any delay in these activities can delay the completion of the project. So, we will see more about critical path, how and the network, how they are drawn, and various aspects related to first PERT and later on CPM. Now, when we are looking at the advantages of PERT and CPM, so we know very well that a real life project is very large and complex and complicated, having large number of activities or tasks in a project, and so we have to see that these questions become very important. Every project manager needs the answers to these questions. First question is, when will the entire project be completed? Because as I said earlier, that we require a time frame in which the project has to be completed. Many a times we are given a time goal, a deadline, and you know very well that if it is a large infrastructure project, and so sometimes the penalty term is also associated, that if the project is not completed, let us say by 30th June 2016, then the penalty may be imposed on the agency which is involved in the project. So, this is the first and crucial question, that when will the entire project be completed. The second aspect is, what are the critical activities or tasks in the project? That is the ones that will delay the entire project if they are late. As I have said that the network is drawn, critical path having the longest length is identified. Now, all those activities which are on the critical path are called critical activities. Why they are called critical activities? Because any delay, even a small amount of delay in any of these critical activities will actually delay the whole project. Then third aspect is, which are the non-critical activities? It is not that we are concerned only with the critical activities. We need to have information about what are the non-critical activities also. These are the ones that can run late without delaying the entire project's completion. In other words, we have a cushion period available for these non-critical activities, so that these activities can be delayed up to certain extent, up to the extent of the cushion time available for each non-critical activity, without actually delaying the entire project's completion. Fourth question involved here is, if there are three time estimates. I said that in PERT we will be using the probabilistic time estimates. So when we are using in PERT three time estimates, then what is the probability that the project will be completed by a specific date? Because when we are using probabilistic time estimates, then we cannot be certain about the project completion date, and in that case we may be requiring to calculate the probability of completing the project by a certain specific date. Now, fifth is, at any particular date. Now, this is about monitoring when the project has been started. So, at any particular date, is the project on schedule, behind schedule or ahead of schedule? And so, a project manager will come to know that if the project is going as per schedule, then he need not bother much about it, But if the project is behind schedule, then he will have to speed up some of the activities so that it gains the lost time. And also the project manager must know if the project is going ahead of schedule. While ahead of schedule may not be much of a problem, but still the project manager has to be sure that whether any quality is not being compromised in order to speed ahead in the project. So, these three aspects of step number 5 refer to the project monitoring when the project is already underway. Sixth aspect is, on any given date, is the money spent equal to, less than or greater than the budgeted amount? As I said that you will have the time budget and you will have the cost budget. And cost budget is more useful in CPM. In PERT, we are primarily concerned with the time budget. So, this point number 6 is referring to the CPM, which says that on any given date, is the money spent equal to, less than or greater than the budgeted amount. Seventh is that, are there enough resources available to finish the project on time? Meaning thereby that the total resources which have been made available to you, whether these resources are adequate to complete the project on time. Then eighth is that, if the project is to be finished in a shorter amount of time, what is the best way to complete this at the least cost? This again is an issue related to the CPM model. Now, proceeding further, we take one example of primarily PERT first, then for CPM later on. So, here in this table, we are given the information about the activities and immediate predecessors. For manual calculation purposes, we take up a very small project. I said that a real life project will have thousands of activities, but in this particular project, we are having only 8 activities here. Namely, they are activity A for building internal components. That is the description of it. In the immediate predecessor column, you are seeing the blank here for activity A. Similarly, for activity B, which is to modify roof and floor, here also you see the blank here. The blank indicates that both activity A and B are the beginning activity of the project, because both of them are not having any immediate predecessor activities. But when we move ahead, we see the activity number C, and that is related to construction of collection stake. Now, construction of collection stake is an activity which requires A as its immediate predecessor. In technological terms, it means that first we have to build internal components, and then only once activity A has been totally completed, then only we can construct collection stake, that is activity C. Similarly, for activity D, which is pouring concrete and installing frame, we require the activity B, that is modifying roof and floor, to be completed, then only activity D can begin. So, in other words, we can say that activity A and B are beginning activities with nil immediate predecessors, activity C has A as its IP, activity D has B as its IP, IP meaning thereby immediate predecessor. Further, we have activity E, which requires activity C to be completed. Then activity F is there, which also requires activity C to be completed. Now, activity G, second last activity, that is installing air pollution device, requires two of its preceding activities, that is D and E, to be completed, then only this installation can be done. And finally, the activity H is there, which requires inspecting and testing, and then this activity also requires F and G as its IP activities. So, from this table, it is very clear to us that some of the activities can have no immediate predecessor activities. That was the example in case of A and B. Some of the activities are having only one IP activity. That was the case for C and D, as well as E and F also. We also saw that a particular activity can become immediate predecessor to more than one activity. That we saw in case of C, which was having both E and F as its successor activities. Similarly, we also saw that some activities can have more than one immediate preceding activities. That was seen in case of G and H, where we found D and E and F and G respectively as their IP activities. Friends, description of the activities and knowledge about immediate predecessor is very important. Before that, we can proceed further for any other aspect in PERT. Now, we have, based on these descriptions of the activities and their immediate preceding relationships, a network can be drawn. Because it is a small project involving only 8 activities, the network can easily be developed. On the left hand side, you see the start, and when we start with both the activities A and B, which are the beginning activities. As I said, that both activities A and B are not having any preceding activities, therefore, both A and B must be starting from the same point of time, and then we see further that activity C requires activity A as its IP activity. So, in the network you are seeing activity C is starting at the point where activity A is finishing. Similarly, when we see the lower side of the figure, we find that activity D has been started only after activity B has been finished. Then you may recall that activity E and F both were having the common immediate predecessor in activity C. So, both activity E and F are emanating from the activity C. But at the same time, when we have to see that activity G requires both D and E, so then activity D and E both are merging into G, and from there G is actually proceeding further. Similarly, for completion of the final activity H, we require both F and G. So, you see the arrows merging into activity H, and towards the extreme right we see the finish sign. So, every project has a definite beginning and definite ending, and the information which was given to us in the form of activities and preceding relationships in the form of immediate predecessor activities, this has been very nicely shown in this particular network. Now, many a times we know that activity times are known with certainty. That would be the situation of CPM, and in CPM we assign just one time estimate to each activity, and this is used to find the critical path. As I said, CPM is a deterministic model, while in many other projects there is uncertainty about activity times. As I said, some new projects are there, the information about the activity times are not known to us with certainty, and in those situations we will be using PERT. Because PERT employs a probability distribution based on 3 time estimates for each activities. A weighted average of these time estimates is used for the calculation of the one time estimate, and this is also used to determine the critical path as well. Now, let us see what are these 3 time estimates which are given for each activity. The time estimates in PERT are, number 1 is optimistic time. As the name itself suggests, optimistic time is the earliest possible time an activity can be completed if everything goes as planned or as well as possible. The notation here is small a. Similarly, the pessimistic time denotes small b, and this is the worst time, it will take the largest for an activity to be completed because of the conditions which are highly unfavorable. While most likely time estimate lies between these 2 extremes of optimistic and pessimistic time, and this is the most realistic time estimate to complete the activity. So, friends, in this part of the film we were talking about the application of both PERT and CPM in project planning, scheduling and controlling. We also learnt that PERT is useful for new projects where probabilistic time estimates are used, and CPM is used for deterministic projects, where repetitive kind of projects where deterministic time estimates are required. Both PERT and CPM are highly useful in managing real life complex mega projects so that both the time and cost budgets of these projects can be fulfilled. Thank you very much.